The angel said, "Do not be afraid, for I am bringing you good news of great joy. To us is born this day in the city of David a Savior, the Messiah, the Lord." Welcome to our Christmas Eve service of lessons and carols. We will hear familiar lessons read and familiar carols sung. And once again, we will remember God's gracious gift to the world. Join me as we prepare our hearts and minds to receive God's presence with us tonight. Join with me for a moment of silence and our invocation. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus, on this night we worship you and celebrate the birth of your Son. May we experience your presence as we worship you. As we read sacred scripture and sing familiar carols, may our hearts be filled with gratitude for your great gift to our world. Bless our worship and our continued service to you. Amen. On this holiest of night, we come joining the shepherds who are stunned by wonder.
On this most silent night, we come, our hopes and dreams joining those of Mary and Joseph.
On this night of carols and candlelight, we come, our glad songs joining with the choirs of angels.
We come to hear good tidings of great joy. Christ the Lord is born.
This is good news of great joy for all people.
Let us break forth together into singing, for the Lord gives hope to his people.
The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them the light has shined.
Jesus Christ is the light of the world.
The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it.
We call his name Emmanuel,
for he is God with us.
Tonight, we celebrate the birth of Christ by lighting the Christ candle. Joy to the world, the Lord is come.
Our first lesson is from the prophet Isaiah. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, as warriors rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning, will be fuel for the fire. For unto us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this.
How far is it to Bethlehem? Not very far. Shall we find the stable room lit by a star? Can we see the little child? Is he within? If we lift the wooden latch, may we go in. Oh, what can I give to him, poor as I am? If I were a shepherd, I'd bring a lamb. If I were a wise man, I'd do my part. Yet what can I give to him? Give him my heart.
In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you, so that the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she, who was said to be unable to conceive, is in her sixth month. For no word from God will ever fail." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. May your word to me be fulfilled. Then the angel left her.
Traveled many moonless nights, cold and weary, with a babe inside, and I wonder what I've done. I am waiting in a silent prayer. I am frightened by the load I bear. In a world as cold as stone, must I walk this path alone? Be with me now. Be with me now. Breath of heaven, hold me together. Be Do you wonder as you watch my face if a wiser one should have had my place? But I offer all I am for the mercy of your plan. breath of heaven.
In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. And so everyone went to their own town to register. Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and lineage of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." And suddenly a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." And so they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who were lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what they had been told about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which was just as they had been told. This season usually involves traveling, and visitors. And most of the time, the visits and the visitors are predictable. We make our plans months in advance, and we keep the rest of our family informed. While there are always some last-minute changes, we usually follow predictable patterns and traditions with our Christmas season. At least, that is how we normally want our Christmases to go. This year is bringing disruption and changed patterns. For many of us, our normal patterns will have to wait until next year. Hopefully, we will be able to return to our more normal and predictable patterns. Our patterns are something of a contrast with that first Christmas. In that case, there was a lot of strange and unexpected visitors. It was not the repetition of a familiar pattern. Instead, it was a new, strange pattern. It had begun more than a year earlier when an old man was serving his time as a priest in the temple. He was from the tribe of Levi, and it was his turn to offer sacrifices and officiate in the temple in Jerusalem. He was following the routine that he knew so well. He was alone there inside the holy place when suddenly he was surprised by an angel who appeared and gave him the good news that he and his elderly wife were going to be parents of a bouncing baby boy. He reminded the angel of the cold, hard facts of life. He was an old man, and his wife was no spring chicken herself. And although they had wanted a child for decades, that was not going to be their lot in life. He had already resigned himself to that fate. Well, the visitor in the holy place didn't take kindly to being lectured to about reality. He announced that Zechariah would not speak again until after that baby boy would be born. And so after Zechariah's tour of duty in the temple was completed, with his mouth shut and not saying a word, he returned home, and a short time later, his wife Elizabeth became pregnant. 6 months later, this same angel named Gabriel made another unexpected visit. This time he appeared to Mary and gave her the shocking news that she also was going to have a son. Now, Mary's news was even more shocking than the news that her elderly relative Elizabeth had received. While it was not unheard of for an elderly woman to unexpectedly conceive for the first time, Gabriel's news to Mary was that she was going to have a child conceived by the Holy Ghost. And this is the way that this story gets started. An angel appears and announces two unlikely births. That is the background from Luke chapter 1 that precedes our reading for tonight. And so 9 months later, Mary is approaching her due date. It so happens that some official in the Roman government thought that it would be a good idea for the tax rolls to be updated throughout the empire. For the Jews, this meant that they all had to return to their family's original land to be recorded for the census. The Roman Empire wanted to make sure that every person was accounted for and that no one missed being counted for the annual tax that Rome required. Government bureaucrats never take into account the burden that their rules will have on ordinary people. There was no allowance made for pregnant women. So even though Mary needed to be at home in Nazareth, nevertheless, she made the trip to Bethlehem with Joseph. For Joseph, he was traveling back home. These were his people. For Mary, she was meeting the family. It probably was awkward for Mary. It likely was awkward for Joseph's family as well. Bethlehem was filled with family members from all over Judea. They were all returning to their tribal home. Modern readers of this story often place our 21st century worldview on this story. We imagine Holiday Inns flashing no vacancy signs and tired innkeepers turning travelers away. But this story is more about a government decision that forced a family reunion. The descendants of David returned to their ancestral hometown, and the only place to stay is in family members' homes. They arrived not at a stranger's business, but at a relative's home. And once every guest room is filled, the family spills over into the livestock room built onto the side of the house. Every family member is cared for, even if the stable is the last room available. There, at least, they are safe and protected. And there, surrounded by Joseph's family, Mary delivers the baby and places him in the manger. And then those angels show up again, this time singing as a choir. They sang, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace, goodwill toward humankind." And they celebrate the arrival of the strangest visitor of all, Emmanuel, God with us. God moves into our neighborhood and takes up residence. And God looks different than we had always imagined. He looked a lot like us. And so on this Christmas Eve, we celebrate the coming of the Christ child. And while we read these birth narratives, we know that this was just the beginning of God with us. The child would grow and become a man, and he would continue showing us what God was like. He would do what the Old Testament writings and rituals could only point toward. He is the clearest revelation of what God is really like. And that is why we read the words he spoke. We listen to the stories that he told. We watch how he treated people, because his words and actions reveal God to us. And that's the reason we spend our lives pondering the question, what would Jesus do? Tonight, we welcome the Christ child into our world. Amen.
Sleep. night with the angels. Let us sing Alleluia to our King. Christ the Savior is born. Christ the Savior is born.
Now receive this benediction. May the love of God, the light of Christ, and the joy of the Holy Spirit abide with you this holy night and forevermore. Amen.